My castaway this week is an intellectual and philosopher. He was born in Latvia 82 years ago, but his family moved to St. Petersburg and then to England, arriving here when he was 10 years old. He himself does not believe that his traditional British education, St. Paul's School, London, and Corpus Christi, Oxford, gave any hint of the distinguished career that was to come. Nevertheless, he's now regarded as one of the most brilliant scholars of his age, a man whose enormous learning has made him an analytical master of the swirling ideas of this century. During the last war, Winston Churchill, it said, delighted in his dispatches from Washington and Moscow. Today, scholars all over the world continue to enjoy the benefits of his wisdom. He is Sir Isaiah Berlin. You're an intellectual and a philosopher. I suppose it's too much to ask that you're a practical man as well and could exist on our desert island.
I doubt if I could survive. I'm not very practical. I don't know what I could do on a desert island. I couldn't build a boat. I wouldn't know what to eat. So I didn't know which roots I could eat or which berries are poisonous. I don't think I could catch fish with my bare hands.
So you're not going to have a very easy time on the island. Would you panic, do you think?
No, I wouldn't panic, because I don't think I'm very panicable by nature, but I'd be very gloomy, because I don't like extended solitude.
But as a man whose life's work has been philosophy and ideas, would you be able to avoid loneliness? Would you be able to keep yourself company by going inside your own head as
well? I don't think so. No. The thought of simply being sunk in thought for hours and hours and hours is not what I do. I think when I read books and react, or when I talk to people and react. Simply to sit in a chair and think is not at all my habit.
What about music, though? Would that be your salvation? Is it your salvation?
Oh, yes, if I could, I'd be very, very miserable without it. It's been my accompaniment all my life, practically. I can't conceive of any degree of happiness without it.
What's the first record that you put on your gramophone?
Ah, yes, that's a record which comes from the opera Boris Godunov by Mussorgsky, the Russian composer. I'll tell you why I chose it. The very first piece of what might be called important music, good music, in fact, to which I was exposed, was in Petrograd, as the Petersburg was called at the time, in 1916, in the Mariinsky Theatre, now called Kirov, called Mariinsky again. It was sung, well, the main part was sung by Sharapin, who created the role. Well, I remember nothing at all about it. I was six, except for one thing. When he sees the ghost of the murdered Prince Dmitri, whom he's regarded as having murdered, he becomes very frightened. And Shalapin crawled under the table, pulled the tablecloth over his head, and sang from underneath the table. That a child would remember, and I always have. Hence, this is the scene, or portion of it, which I would like to hear again.
Я только не хотел, чур дитя, не я, нет, не я, воля народа, чур дитя, чур.
The clock scene from Mussorgsky's Boris Godunov, sung by Fyodor Shalyapin, with the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Max Steinman. The fact, Sir Isaiah Berlin, that your parents were taking you to the opera when you were just 6 years old would indicate that your family was cultured and possibly affluent too. Would that be fair?
Well, not very affluent. My family was never either very rich or poor. They were perfectly ordinary bourgeois family who, so to speak, my father earned sufficient income to keep us going.
What was the family business?
Timber. My father was a timber merchant. He inherited it from his great-grandfather, who was a very rich man, who owned forests in western Russia. And these forests were cut by peasants and then floated down the river Dvina to Riga, which is where my family comes from.
The Baltic seaport.
That's right, Baltic seaport in Latvia. And then it was sawn in Riga and then sailed to the west. And my father was the man who used to go to England, France, Germany, to sell it.
And then you moved from Riga to St. Petersburg, or Petrograd, as it had become, and you were living there in 1917. You'd have been 8 when the revolution broke out. Did you witness or experience any of it?
The first revolution was like something on the stage. Great crowds, people walking about with exalted faces, everyone very happy. I don't think perhaps the Tsarists were very happy, but my family was, because they were sort of ordinary liberal bourgeois. And then, let me see, the thing which I remember painfully on that occasion was the fact that there was a man sort of caught by a lynching bee. Let me explain. The only people who remained loyal to the Tsar were the police. That's not in the books, but it is true. And they sniped the revolutionaries from roofs or attics and things. And this man was dragged down, obviously, by a crowd, was being obviously taken to a not very agreeable fate. And I saw this man struggling in the middle of a crowd of about 20, dragged off. Well, I didn't realize he was a policeman. I was told that afterwards. But that gave me permanent horror of physical violence, which has remained with me for the rest of my life.
Let's have your second record.
That is the record from Verdi's opera, Traviata. My memory of that is the following. My mother had a very pretty voice, pretty soprano voice, something between a contralto and a soprano. She wanted to be a singer. She got the composer Rimsky-Korsakov to admit her to the conservatoire in Petersburg. Her father was a religious bigot of the most terrible sort. Wouldn't have a piano in the house, didn't give her money to go to the capital city, was altogether a most oppressive old gentleman whom I never liked. So she couldn't go. But she always sang. And what she sang was arias from the kind of operas which the German opera house in Riga did in the early 20th century. What did that mean? Traviata, Rigoletto, Trovatore, Carmen, things of that sort. I mean, Marta, which has a beautiful tenor aria, and so on. And my mother used to sing this at home, I thought, very beautifully. And what she sang very beautifully was this particular aria. Not perhaps as well as Tebaldi will sing it. But it made a deep impression on me at that period. I loved Verdi, I loved Bizet, I loved all the composers she sang. She never sang Puccini, which is why I acquired a definite permanent distaste for him.
Renata Tebaldi singing part of the aria A Forse e Lui from Act 1 of Verdi's La Traviata with the orchestra of the Academy of St. Cecilia, Rome, conducted by Francesco Molinari Pradelli. So you and your family left in 1920 for England, and you were just over